Hello, and welcome to Look, Look, and Look Again, where we enjoy going retro and admiring things all culty and hip, whether in TV or film. Would you, Adam and Eve, that we're at number 19 of our review, and we go to the Orient, the Mystic Orient. In today's show, we say ni hao to a diabolical mastermind, as we take a peek at a movie that was severely cut for many years for its racist and stereotypical representation of the Chinese community. All those snowflakes are gonna have a blue vinegar fit with tonight's show. Just go and protest about something on campus, or something to fill or your spare time. Maybe read some Marxist doctrine or something. Hang on, you probably get taught a lot of Marxism at this university, at the university that you're at anyway, so look for an alternative. I know, censor some old classic literature. You like doing that, don't you? Anyway, we go back to the 1930s as we fall to the mercy of the Yellow Peril. So without further ado, on Look, Look, and Look Again, it's... Quite recently, I have had the pleasure of watching some of the old Johnny Weissmuller Tarzan movies, and concerning Tarzan the Ape Man and Tarzan and His Mate, I noticed how grown up these were. This is most relevant in the second Tarzan movie, Tarzan and His Mate, where romanticism combines with eroticism as Tarzan chucks Jane into the lake and a branch rips her dress clean off, resulting in Jane swimming in her birthday suit. A wonderful sequence, but how daring it was too, especially for 1934. Then I realized these features were not victim to the Hays Code. Remember that evil piece of censorious puritanism that afflicted mainstream Hollywood from 1935 onwards. Fortunately, before this, there was a golden age where, between 1929 and 1934, mainstream studios such as Metro-Goldwyn-Mayer, Warner Brothers and Universal gave the public unbridled thrills, genuine horror and titillation, and where directors could express visually what they wanted, within some boundaries. We are in the 30s here after all, without the burden or constraints or fuck-wittedness of morality guardians. Those are those narrow-minded people who crusade for moral decency when deep down their jealousy is a root cause of seeing people doing things they always desire to do or behaving like they always wanted to behave. But the majority have been brought up, oppressed, and usually tainted by religious dogma. Therefore, if I can't be like that, none of you shall either. I'm sure you understand the mentality of such prudishness, dear viewer. Alas, plenty of these people still exist. Way back, not that long ago really, in Look, Look, Look Again, I reviewed Mystery of the Wax Museum. Do you remember? It was another triumph of the pre-Hays Code era, with its genuine scares, racy wisecracks, and a very liberal tone. I was delighted to view something as big as an enjoyment, if not more so, in the cinematic guise of The Mask of Fu Manchu. I would say this is a pre-code masterpiece, and a total must-see for fans of adventure, horror, and science fiction. Oh, and of course, vintage salaciousness. Due to the freedom of pre-code, we are presented with Art Deco masochism at its most ingenious. We are treated to amples of flesh, boundless female emancipation, and spates of violence. Some of the like we would never see again until the 1960s. Mask of Fu Manchu combines all these elements in its scant 68-minute running time and leaves you craving for more. Personally, I think this is a perfect consummation of its genre and is a prime example of a liberated early 1930s cinema. One also realizes how much of the film's formula was pinched to produce the overrated Indiana Jones movies and just how underrated Mask of Fu Manchu is. Fu Manchu was the creation of Arthur Henry Sarsfield Ward, who writes under the pen name of Sax Roma. He found success with a succession of Fu Manchu novels in which the diabolical mastermind attempts varied ways of world domination and spreading the menace of the, in italics I say this, yellow peril to the West, a bit like fanatical Islam in this day and age. And before you jump on your high horses, I say fanatical Islam. As we know from such characters, there has to be a just foil for fiendishness, and this was in the form of Dennis Nayland Smith and his sidekick Dr. Petri. In a Holmes-Watson relationship, both battle against Fu Manchu's fiendish master plans involving elaborate traps, bizarre scientific weapons, and even germ warfare.
What are you going to do?
Santo! Hoi toke, hey!
The movie version of Mask of Fu Manchu was an adaptation which followed hot on the heels of the printed serial penned by Roma, appearing in Collier's magazine in early 1932. The movie begins in the United Kingdom and sees Nayland Smith of the British Secret Service visiting renowned Egyptologist Sir Lionel Barton. He seeks Barton's assistance and divulges the whereabouts of the sacred tomb of Genghis Khan. Smith needs to set up an expedition urgently to get to the tomb which houses the sacred mask and the sword of Khan. It is vital and will be a race against time, as they need to claim the treasure before the fiendish Fu Manchu. Manchu plans to utilize the treasures to claim he is the reincarnation of Genghis Khan and intends to inflame the peoples of Asia and the Middle East, thus causing an uprising where the white race is wiped out or enslaved and Manchu becomes the dictator. Manchu arranges Barton to be kidnapped and he is taken to Manchu's lair, where he is bribed into revealing the treasure's whereabouts. Fu Manchu even offers the pleasures of his daughter, Fa Lo Si, but Barton retains his stiff upper lip only and refuses. When all else fails, Fu Manchu puts Barton to the torture, and his fiendish method will be by the giant bell. Barton is carried to a table and tethered down. Above him is a huge bell about to be rang by Manchu's henchmen. Before the torture, Manchu gleefully tells Barton, "The percussion and repercussion of sound against your eardrums will soften and destroy them until the sound is magnified 1,000 times. You can't move. You can't sleep. You will be frantic with thirst. You will be unspeakably foul. But here you will lie day after day until you tell." Unfortunately, Barton's sufferance begins, and after a long stint of the cruelest sort of campanology, comes a moment of sheer twistedness and classic cinematic spite. Fu Manchu halts the proceedings to give Barton water. Barton promptly spits it out. "Oh, I forgot to tell you, it was salted," Fu Manchu tells Barton, who by now is edging to the brink of madness from torture and dehydration. "How evil is that?" In Barton's absence, his beautiful daughter Sheila requests she should be part of the expedition, as she also knows where the tomb is. She is joined by her hunky fiancé Terence, Terry Granville, and has the support of others for an expedition as well. Eventually the tomb is found and the mask and sword is taken. Nayland Smith also joins the party. Learning of the discovery, Fu Manchu sends his coolies to steal the artifacts, but the robbery is thwarted. Concerned about the welfare of her father and the jeopardy of the expedition, Sheila asks Terry to take the sword and mask to Fu Manchu. However, they have been switched by fakes by Nayland, who is one step ahead of the game, knowing there will be multiple attempts at stealing the goods. At Manchu's lair, Terry arrives and presents the mask and sword, but after they are analysed by one of Fu Manchu's scientific instruments, they are proved to be replicas. In a rage, Fu puts Terry in the hands of his daughter for some cruel punishment. Terry is led to the dungeon, stripped and then whipped for the pleasure of Fa Lo Se, which she seems to enjoy with orgasmic relish.
The whips! Aye! Faster! 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 Let him down! Untie him! He is not entirely unhandsome.
Eventually, Manchu sends Sheila the corpse of her father, and to prevent the same fate befalling her fiancé, Nayland Smith ventures to Manchu's lair to free Terry from bondage, but the attempt fails and he too is captured. Terry is taken to Fu Manchu and is injected with a hypno serum, where he is under the spell of Fu Manchu and will carry out everything he is asked to do. Manchu sends him to Sheila and Professor Von Berg, stating that Nayland Smith requires the sword and mask and everything is fine. Sheila realizes Terry is not behaving like the man she loves, but Von Berg obligates and gives the mask and sword straight into the hands of Fu Manchu and ultimately entraps himself and Sheila in the process. Fu Manchu finally has them all in the palm of his hand, and he has some fiendish ways of dealing with them. Sheila he nominates for the sacrificial westerner, where she will be slayed by Khan's sword in front of his Asian followers. Poor Terry will be drugged again and will become the plaything and slave of Fu's daughter. Nayland Smith is taken away and placed on a seesaw, with the end carrying him tilting further and further into a pit of crocodiles as the sands of time run out. Meanwhile, poor Von Berg is strapped to a seat with a wall of spikes either side edging nearer. Fortunately, Smith manages to untie his bond and escapes by using the crocodiles as a walkway to the stairs leading up from the pit. I believe Roger Moore's James Bond did the same thing about four decades later. Smith finally frees Terry and saves Von Berg from being a human pincushion. As Terry makes his way to save his sweetheart from a fiendish sacrifice, so Nayland and Von Berg utilize one of Fu Manchu's weapons, a lethal electric death ray. As Sheila is about to be slaughtered after Fu Manchu spins the crowd into a frenzy with the immortal lines of, "Would you all have maidens like this for your wives? Then conquer and breed, kill the white man and take his woman." Terry bursts onto the scene, Nayland and Von Berg blast Fu with his laser, and he loses his grip on his sword. Terry snatches it and starts chopping Fu Manchu to pieces with the sword of Khan. They then turn the laser on the groups of congregated fanatics, rendering them to burnt carbon, thus saving the world from domination and the yellow peril. The heroes then journey back to England, and on the overseas hall, dispatch the Sword of Khan into the ocean, free from the clutches of the fiendish Fu Manchu. So ends this wondrous slice of pre-Haze Code joy. Boris Karloff is superb as the villainous Fu, and provides he is to the 30s what Cheney was to the 1920s. He was reputed to have spent 4 hours in makeup in the morning before the shoot began to achieve the desired aesthetic. Sax Roma was also pleased on the choice of actor, as Karloff's lisp made Fu Manchu more snake-like. Here Karloff adds such zeal to his performance, attacking it with such relishness, it is potentially one of his finest performances. Myrna Loy is also superb, as his wicked daughter, and combines the piquant charm of an oriental porcelain doll with the Sadean perverseness of a dominatrix. Admittedly, one can understand why this was a controversial piece, as there is a hefty chunk of sex and violence on display, and quite regularly the two are woven together. A censor's absolute nightmare, an exploitation fan's joy. It seems the object of affection is that of Terry Granville, played by the ruggedly handsome Charles Starrett, and with his good looks it is understandable why he has Farlow C and Daddy Fu in a bit of a spin. But surprisingly even more is the perversity that accompanies such sequences. As we have seen, one of the most censored segments is when Terry is taken to the dungeon, manacled and hoisted, his shirt is then ripped off, and two muscle-bound black men, scantily clad, start to whip him. As we had witnessed, the sequence plays out to a frenzied sound of whip cracks, moans of sufferance, and utterances of dominant pleasure. It is fucking brilliant. In another sequence, Terry is strapped to a table wearing the skimpiest of loincloths as Manchu prepares the hypnoserum injection. It seems the daughter is not the only admirer, as before the injection is administered, Manchu runs his talons over Terry's writhing body. The camera delights in providing us such a homoerotic moment as Terry thrusts his groin towards the camera as he tries to wriggle free, and therefore frequently tenses, revealing the actor's superb muscle definition for the pleasure of the audience. This is, in fact, pretty hot stuff. As this occurs, so Fa So Li concludes, "He is not entirely unhandsome, is he, my father?" To which Fu Manchu retorts, "For a white man, no." Predictably, the movie pissed the Chinese community off, causing the embassy in Washington to complain about the negative representation of the Chinese in the picture. I can understand their moan, as they are not represented in a positive light at all. Personally, in 2019, I just found it to come across as rather charmingly ignorant. In one scene that made me chuckle, Fu Manchu reveals his dastardly deeds to Sheila. Wide-eyed and in shock, she recoils in horror and then exclaims, "You yellow beast!" Such instances really appreciate how far we have evolved with our understanding of foreigners, but one can't help but delight in the stereotyping that creates proper villains out of cultural difference. Did I believe this was a true representation of all Chinamen throughout the world? No. Did it make me laugh at how we saw Chinamen back in the early 1930s? Yes, it did. The sets for The Mask of Fu Manchu are an Art Deco triumph. Sleek, elegant, hard-lined and brightly lit with a veneer of class that also goes for some of Fu Manchu's diabolical contraptions as well. One can see from the designs how this inspired the Doctor Who story, The Talons of Wang Chiang, which in my opinion is one of the best stories ever produced for Doctor Who. In The Mask of Fu Manchu, the sets are just so impressive. From the laboratories to the grand lair of Fu, the camera picks it all up with superb long shots which blend the clinical with the oriental, thanks to the directional craftsmanship of Charles Brabin and the cinematography by Tony Gaudio. What a combined talent. In one sequence, Fu Manchu can be seen next to a huge magnifier, which reflects his image but distorts and wraps it, representing the sort of character Fu Manchu is. Rather twisted. Such sequences like that are littered throughout and should be applauded. Some of the shadows and light are also used to great effect too, and could only be eclipsed by the works of F.W. Murnau and Karl Dreyer. This film has it all, and I cannot impress upon you to hunt down a copy. Ensure, though, it is the full version you view. The prints that initially circulated were severely truncated of all the good bits, mainly the sex, sadism, and the current social bogeyman, racism. Even as late as 1992, the VHS print in circulation on VHS cassette was shorn of the hate speeches, but finally the offending footage has been restored from a 16mm print of the movie. Thank God this survives. Other pre-Hays Code films of in the horror genre of note are The Old Dark House, Murders in the Rue Morgue, and Island of Lost Souls. But I have to conclude that Mask of Fu Manchu knocked the lot of them into a cocked hat. I enjoyed this as much, if not more so, than Mystery of the Wax Museum, and even what we are brainwashed into believing are classics of the horror genre does not stand up against this wonderful, wonderful film. As you can tell from this review, I absolutely adore this movie, and hope you do too. Definitely, The Mask of Fu Manchu ranks in my top 20 movies of all time. Go and secure a copy, and I really do and sincerely hope you enjoy watching this essay in fiendishness as much as I did. Thank you for watching. Cheerio.
Kill the white man and take his women.